This is September 4th, 1987. My name is Joe Todd. This is an interview with Walter Riley O'Neill in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Okay.
I'm a native of Illinois, recently out of the land of enchantment. I was a little too young to be a Sooner, but I would like to make a statement. The descendants of the Sooners have built a beautiful city, a city of long distances, well-kept lawns, beautiful homes, wonderful man-made lakes, and a state with a history, heritage, and no other state can match. I just feel like I'm falling in love with this great state of Oklahoma. Now you can.
Thank you. Sir, where were you born?
In a very little town in St. Francisville, Illinois. It is a river town on the Wabash River where Lincoln made many, many stops. I have a picture of it, that would be great book. And I left my family, with my minister, my father was a minister, and he moved around quite a little. They left this town when I was 4 years old. Years later, I went back. My mother told me the house I'd been born in. I went back, and that place was a vacant lot. But I do have a brother buried there. He was 4 years old when he died, and I was born the next week. I had six sisters, and when I was born, naturally, they thought I was to replace the boy that they just buried. And they made a just for me to death. I never did get over it. I'm still spoiled a little.
When's your birthday?
May 6th, 1895. You mean when I was born?
Yes, sir.
1895.
Who was your father?
Reverend James O'Neill. Christian minister for 40 years.
And your mother?
Her name is Cornelison. Her family is all Irish.
What was her first name?
Mary Bell. Mary Bell O'Neill.
And where were your parents from? Where were they born?
They were from the border state of Kentucky during the Civil War, you remember. The Kentucky stayed with the Union, but many of their inhabitants went with the South. My grandfather had been captain on the rivers in the West, you know. And he had six brothers, five of them fought for the Confederacy. He came north and fought for the Union. So I guess
what was his name?
Sir?
What was his name?
James Harvey, is that?
James Harvey.
James Harvey.
O'Neill.
You say he was a river captain?
Yes.
On the paddle wheelers?
Yes, on the paddle wheelers, you know, that went up and down the river there.
You have any stories about him?
Sir?
You have any stories you've heard about him?
Well, one day somebody asked him, there's a lot of snags in that river, you know. He said, do you know where all those snags are? How do you mess them with your boat? He said, no, I don't know where they are. I just know where they are not.
That's pretty good.
Mm-hmm. Do you know, did he own the ship? Did he work for a company?
No, sir. He worked for some of the big shipping companies.
You know the name of the companies?
No, I do not. I kicked myself 1,000 times that I didn't ask my father more about my grandfather. He was 50 years old when the Civil War broke out, but he joined up anyway. He was a friend of Morgan. Morgan was a Confederate leader. They grew up together in Kentucky there. And when Morgan made his trip around the Union Army, he picked up my grandfather as a prisoner. And as soon as he recognized him, he turned him loose, of course. And Morgan then was captured as he tried to cross back over the river. And that's about all I know of my grandfather, except he was badly wounded at Stone River. And when they began giving pensions to the Union soldiers alive, he had to have witnesses that seen him, picked him up on the field. And his wife eventually was, or he was eventually granted a pension of $6 a month.
Now you say your father was a minister.
Minister, yes.
And the family left St. Francisville when you were 4 years old?
Yes, sir.
And where did the family move?
They went to a small town called Keensburg, Illinois. That's where I spent my first 12 years. In the Wabash River bottoms, a beautiful, beautiful country.
Did you attend school in Keensburg?
Keensburg, K-E-N-S-B-U-R-G.
Keensburg. Okay, did you attend school there?
Yes.
How big is Keensburg?
Well, at one time it was a real good town. Let me tell you about it. I left there, as I said, 12 years old. And I wrote this book when I was 82 years old. And I said that I had seen lots of the world, Europe in World War I, Japan, and the Philippines World War II. But I've never forgotten my wonderful youth in this little town just over a bridge that they built recently. Now, many, many years later, I was back in this country. I didn't remember the bridge. It wasn't there 69 years old when we kids had staked out this territory. But it was a wonderful town, 10 miles from the county seat. And in the winter, the whole town would go on pay rides, skating party on the pond. Summer, the boys would always spend fishing. Wonderful town. One of my sisters was born there, and that's the only one that was. Then we went to a German town called Huntingburg, and that was where I got my acquaintance with football. Huntingburg was about like Oklahoma City. It was a football town, always in running for the state championship. But I'd never seen a football team. But boy, did I follow them. When they went out of town, I snaked a ride and went with them.
Did you play football?
Yes, all through high school and lots of army teams. Mm-hmm. I was light, but I was pretty fast. Mm-hmm.
Now, what was the name of the football team?
This was a high school team.
It was probably Huntington High School.
No, it was called something else. I just can't remember.
Okay.
I think it was the Huntingburg Raiders, but I'm pretty sure it was.
What year did you graduate from high school?
No. My father moved again to a bigger town, much bigger, Vincennes, Indiana. Entered high school there as a freshman. Then we moved to another town, Oblong, Illinois, where I really made a little history and football, basketball, and baseball.
Tell me about it. Tell me what you did in sports.
Well, I had learned football back in Huntingburg, and when I got to this new high school, the first year I played left tackle. They didn't call them nose guards and all those things in those days. It was just 11 people. Center, two guards, two tackle, two ends, and left, halfback, right halfback, and fullback. But of course, we have replacements to come in if you get injured. I done pretty well, they thought anyway. In basketball, I was very short, but the rest of the team was 6 footers, and I was offered a scholarship at DePaul University in Illinois, but World War I broke out before I could leave. Not World War I, my trip down to Mexico looking for points of view. You know, President Wilson federalized the National Guard, and the guard from each state was sent to the border. We were very disappointed. We thought we would be in, get to go into Mexico and catch that guy, you know. Personally, did go in with several combat, with a 6th colored regiment, and several other detachment, different machine guns and things like that.
Let me back up and ask, when did you join the National Guard?
In those days, you couldn't join the Army unless you were 21 years old, and I had to wait. It just happened, though, that it came just at the right time for me to join the Illinois National Guard. And
where did you join?
Newton, Illinois.
Newton, Illinois.
Yeah.
On your birthday, your 21st birthday, you joined.
My father was a minister, and the National Guard in those days were not the allies of the country, you know, they were. And he didn't want me to join up, but when I was 21, I joined.
Did you have a basic training?
Yeah.
Where did you go for your training?
Texas. Out of San Antonio. It was called the first Camp Wilson.
Okay.
But soon they found out that they couldn't name a camp after a living person, and Wilson was still alive. So they changed the name to Camp Logan in honor of one of Illinois' Civil War generals.
Would you tell me, just describe your basic training, your average day in basic?
Well, my book there says that we drilled and drilled and even got so we could do our manual arms. And the combat training, of course, that's what we liked, because we did expect to be hunting deer in the mountains of New Mexico. We did the usual thing. We'd crawl around under barbed wire and run obstacle courses and use bayonets on the German dummies and would fall and fire the German dummies picking it and popping up all over the place, you know. And we got so we thought we were pretty good. But when we got in France, we found out that we were pretty green.
Yeah. Okay, before we get into France, describe the barracks that you lived in at Camp Logan.
The what?
The barracks at Camp Logan.
Oh,
where you stayed.
It was pyramidal tents. And the tents were large enough for 8 men, a corporal and 7 men. And we have always boarded them up about 4 feet. And in the middle, we had a pyramidal stove. It was like a cone, and the pipe went up through the ceiling so the smoke could go out. It was ideal for eight men.
Okay, what did you have cots to sleep on, or what were you sleeping?
Yes, okay. Cots. Mm-hmm.
And what type of equipment did you train with?
Well, we had bayonets. We were using the Springfield rifle.
The Springfield 03?
Right.
The Springfield model 19-3?
Yes.
Okay.
What was the name of that gun I was telling you about the other night?
I was just remembering, you showed me one in the museum.
Yeah.
But I don't remember the name of it. Something like Kensington or
something? Craig. Yes, they just discarded the Craig.
The Craig Jorgensen?
Yeah.
The Craig Jorgensen 98?
Yeah.
Okay.
And we were now using the Springfield rifle. We had American remedies. And, of course, bayonets. I was a bayonet instructor for a while. And I guess got pretty good.
How did you instruct the men in using the bayonet?
Well, actually, we knew very little about bayonet fighting, and we were training them like this, just like a boxing, holding out like this, and it was very forward. But as soon as I got, they sent instructors from France over there to help us, and they showed us how to use that bayonet. You put the butt right here in your underarm real good. And hold it like this. They couldn't knock the gun out of your hand, you know, and you could come forward with it, usually a butt stroke. And I can't go through all the motions now, I've forgotten them. But,
how often did you have bayonet training?
Every day.
Yeah, every day.
Yeah. You know, they'd play reveille real early. They'd get you up, make you run, do some exercises, for maybe a half an hour, and then you come back and eat breakfast. And then after breakfast, you would start all this training. We made a hike. I may be getting a little ahead of myself. I was in San Antonio.
Camp Logan.
Camp Logan.
This is basic training.
Yeah.
You said you had reveille. What time was reveille?
I can't tell you exactly, but it was with first light, I know that.
I did not ask, when did you join the National Guard? It's on your 21st birthday, yeah. So that would have been
May the 6th, 1916.
Did you think that we would become involved in the war in Europe at that time?
In the meantime, before we go any further, the National Guard was called out to East St. Louis to quell that Negro. Yeah.
I was going to ask about that. Tell me about that.
Well, I had, I was out of the Villa campaign and was working in Attica, Indiana. But I was still a member of the National Guard. And I was called back to active duty to go to East St. Louis to help them quell that race riot. And I was a couple of days late getting there because I was not with the outfit. And when I got there, I was met at the depot by the captain of the company. In the meantime, I got married, and in those days, if you got married, you got discharged from the army. So he had written me a letter stating that, giving me my discharge, but telling me that if I could prove that my wife wouldn't become a burden to the army, he would reinstall me as my present rank of sergeant. So that was accomplished. When I got there, I was met by a captain and a first lieutenant, a first sergeant. They told me a terrible story. A Negro had come to town, a stranger. he got drunk. And the policeman, in attempting to arrest him, the Negro shot the policeman, killed him. And then the town started this uprising, killing every Negro they could find. The captain says when we came in, we could see what they call Negro Town in flames, and bodies were hanging from the rafters. Now this didn't come out in the papers, because they just wouldn't publish it. A lot of them, he told me, went to the theater, the Negro theater, segregated of course, hoping to be safe, but they burnt the theater and shot the Negroes that came out. Now I arrived about this time. They were still throwing ropes around colored women, tying the streetcar and pulling a few times. He, being a sergeant, he says we threw a cordon around the city, gathered all the people together, and arrested the ringleaders, and of course separated the sheep from the goats. The sheep were turned loose, the goats were held for trial. And I got there about this time. He says they are, we have detachments through the city, but they are still chasing Negroes around to catch them, they beat them to death. So he gave me a platoon and told me to patrol the back alleys and the streets. And if I could find any Negroes, to take them under our protection and feed them and take care of them. So I did that. I've been married, and they had rumors around that the Lusitania had just been sunk, and war was going to be declared in France. And my wife is back here at home. As soon as he gave me a section of the city to patrol and keep in order, and when that was done, and I thought it was safe enough, I asked him if I could send for my wife. He said, yes, my wife had done it. And she stayed the rest of the time, and instead of going to France, we were called back to Newton, where we were recruited. Our company up to a strength of 250, which was a card in those days.
What company were you a member of? What unit?
Sure.
What unit were you in the Illinois Guard?
Illinois Guard was called the 4th Illinois Guard, and the 4th Illinois National Guard. And it was... famous. Been in every war from 1812 until this time. But when this convention nationalized, called the 130th Infantry of the 33rd Division.
33rd Division. Yeah. How long were you in East St. Louis?
How long was that?
Were you in East St. Louis for the regiment?
Well, it must have been at least a month.
Were you armed?
When they first went around the city, they had to put their guns, but they were not loaded. But when he gave me this order, he says, carry loaded guns now. And we were shot at several times, but I never felt them shooting at us. When you get in the alley, they'd shoot over your head, you know. He just thought they didn't want to kill a soldier, because they did, they would really be in back, you know. And I was never scared very much of that. I didn't think they were shooting at us.
How many men were in East St. Louis in the National Guard? How many were called out?
The company at that time was not over I have the exact roster in that book, but it couldn't have been over 150. But when we were back to Illinois, we went up to 250.
And how long did the riot last?
It must have been just about a month.
Let me back up. When did you first go to Texas to chase Pancho Villa?
Well,
did you leave from basic training?
In fact, we went before basic. I did. The other boys were pretty well trained, but I was just a greenhorn. And I went with them. And,
so this is before basic training then?
Yes, that's where we had our real basic training.
How did you travel from Illinois to chase Pancho Villa?
On trains. Yeah.
Tell me about the accommodations you had on the train.
Well, it was a troop train. They had someplace. At one time, I was transportation officer in charge of troop trains since World War II. It's just regular passenger trains, but only for soldiers, you know. The soldiers would fill the entire train.
Did you have Pullmans to sleep in?
No, we just slept in seats.
Oh, you just slept in seats.
If we slept at all.
Mm-hmm. And how long, and where did you, from Illinois, where did you go to chase Villa?
Well, that's when we went to San Antonio, Camp Logan. And our basic training there was very, very good. Love it was hard.
Did you go into Mexico?
No, sir, none of us went into Mexico, and that's the reason we called it. We were very disappointed.
Yeah.
Person went in, he couldn't find Villa either. And the Mexican army was watching him. They didn't like it at all to have a foreign army in there. And Wilson didn't want to get the war with Mexico. He knew, almost knew, that he was going to get into World War II. And
so from Camp Logan, did you go to the border?
Yeah.
With Mexico?
Yeah. Yes, we patrolled the border all along.
Tell me about, what were your duties when you patrolled the border? What did you do?
Well, there wasn't much to do, only just walk on guard and carry your rifles. MacArthur was down there, and Patton. They were second lieutenants at that time. They were with the regular army, of course.
How large of a section of the border did your company have to patrol?
Well, from San Antonio to Austin was Austin's the capital. We made that march once a month, under four packs back and forth. And that was our sector from San Antonio to Austin. And the other states had different, all along the border.
And what was your average day on the border? What did you do from the time you got up until the time you went to bed?
Well, when we found out we weren't going across the border, we did a lot of training, of course. And we'd had a wonderful basketball team, semi-pro basketball team in Newton, which was intact. We played everything on the border and basketball. We organized a baseball team and won about half the games of baseball and made this hike to Austin every month. We would pitch a pup tents around the Capitol building and paint the train red that night and start back the next day. So it was not a war, it was just a picnic.
food did you have at that time in the Army?
Well, we had, at that time, it was good food because it was right in the United States, and we had good cooks. We had a mess sergeant that had been in the regular Army, and he knew all the tricks of cheating the commissary out of good food, you know. And we had a supply sergeant who was a hunter in Illinois, and he wanted to try out his skill in Texas. And the first time he shot a deer, he almost got killed because he ran up and this deer all went gored pretty badly, you know. But he recovered, and after that, he punched a lot of fresh meat for us. We eat good on the border.
Is San Antonio the further south you went along the border there?
Yeah.
Okay, you didn't go to the river then, the Rio Grande. Okay. Were you infantry?
Yeah.
Okay. So you didn't have horses on the border then?
No.
Okay.
Well, I say they didn't, but some of the outfits did.
Yeah, the cavalry units probably
yes,
had horses,
yes.
But not the infantry.
Yes.
Okay. Did you have any trucks with you?
This war was the first one. Well, I didn't have any time, but yes, we did. At Camp Furlong, I had a picture of a place that, where they would be able to repair the trucks. And this was, actually, we didn't use them very much. Truck drivers in those days were about as important as aviators are today, because very few people had automobiles, and we didn't know how to drive. If you were alive and you made your truck driver, you were a pretty important man. And if you were a machine gun, if you had a machine gun, you were on a machine gun, a bunch of people would pay you, oh my goodness, any amount of money to join him. But we didn't have many of them either, but a few, and they made lots of money.
So you went to East St. Louis for the race riot, and after the race riot, where did you go?
We went back home, as I say, and recruited up to 250, and then went overseas.
I was going to ask, what was your reaction when you heard about the Lusitania?
About what?
The Lusitania, when it was sunk.
Well, naturally, we were very disappointed with Wilson. He kept writing notes, you know, and we wanted to declare war right quick and get over there, but that was before the sinking of the Lusitania. When it was sunk, everything changed, and he did declare war. We had been married about 13 days when he declared war. And I had got a furlough to go. I knew we were going overseas, so my wife was back in Illinois, and I got a furlough to go back there. As soon as I got there, my father met me at the depot, of course, and mother had a great big dinner. Dad was not too happy for some reason or other, I didn't know why. After dinner, I lit a cigarette. I used to smoke a lot. Drinking a cup of coffee, and he said, "Son, I got something for you. I just got there." He said, "Just came in this morning," so he handed me a telegram. And the telegram said, "All leave time, Cass will get back to your outfit," so I had to go right back to it. And they get right on train and go to Hoboken, New York, get on board for it. Now, we didn't go in a convoy. A convoy took maybe 10 days a week, 2 weeks to get over there. It went slow. But we went on the Kaiser Wilhelm II, and the sister ship, Kaiser Wilhelm I, had been closed. Captured in one of our harbors down where the Warring used to transport troops to, and it was the fastest ships afloat. They figured that they didn't need to go in the convoy because they could outrun any submarine. And I guess they did because we got over there. But they loaded the darn thing. It was a troop ship. It was not a troop ship. It was a passenger ship for 7,000 men. And they loaded the thing with 14,000. So half of us slept at night, half of us stayed on deck during the daytime. I mean, it was a mess, I'll tell you. It was an English ship, an English crew. And our only mess was some kind of stew made from Australian jackrabbits. We just couldn't eat the darn stuff. And we'd find an English sailor, give him a buck or two, and he'd go to his mess and bring us back something to eat.
Tell me, any storms while you were going over?
Not on this trip, no. Later, I was in 5 or 6 big typhoons, but not on this trip.
In leaving New York, did you pass the Statue of Liberty?
Yes.
What did you think of it?
Beautiful view.
And so you left Hoboken, and where did you land?
Brest, France.
What did Brest look like?
It's the southern part of France. What did it look like?
Yes, sir.
Brest had not been injured by the war at all. It was, I don't know, the Germans just said, you're done, that's all right. And we couldn't see too much of Brest because we didn't stay very long. As soon as we got off the boat, we started hiking to the interior. And we were followed by a bunch of French kids. We knew they were orphans. All they could say was cigarettes and money. And we were awfully sorry for them. We gave them all of our money because we were going to have a pity pretty soon. And most of our cigarettes. They followed us quite a ways, and finally we left and come to a camp that Napoleon had used in his day. Napoleon barracks were still there. But at this time, it was occupied by Americans, which was our supply group. And we were free. Before we got on those 40 hollies needs to go train, we were free to roam the countryside, and naturally we did. Every farmhouse had a beautiful cellar full of all kinds of liquors, champagne, any liquor you wanted. And one night, four of us were going around, and we'd had a few drinks of liquor to do like that. Finally come to a house that had champagne, we drank a quarter of it apiece. a dollar a quarter. And we just felt fine, man. We could hold our liquor all right. Well, that farm lady and his wife, old man and his wife, were just looking at us in amazement. They knew what was going to happen. When he got up to leave, we couldn't stand up. We just fell down, crawled all around the floor. And finally found the door and went out, and boy, did they laugh. We got back the next morning, couldn't sleep. No, if you full of champagne, hours later you take a big drink of water, you've got too much gas, you can. And we just went back and see how far we could. We were just kids.
When did you first see the Germans?
We made our way on the beautiful little engines in France. All of them are gauge roads, really. The engines just put like a 10 minutes old, maybe 100 years old, the boys. We got those cars, 40 hollies each row, and they put about 60 of us in there. And all you could do was stand up. One sliding door, people that sat sliding door could look out through the cracks and see the country, but we didn't stay in that too long. And then we started marching toward the front. And in those days, we were going to British front. We discarded our 20 Springfield, left them at home, picked up the English modified Enfield, a bigger rifle and a much better sight on it. Our Springfield, if you ever saw one, had that little bit of a hole, and the thing was pretty hard to get a quick sight through that little hole. But these British Enfields had sights like this. You could see before it put. And we carried French automatic rifles and English grenades, and they had done exactly like the British Army did. They appointed strikers for the officers to polish their boots and get them food, and they made a sergeant's mess. I was always one of the guys that had to go ahead of the advance and pick out barns for the men to sleep in when they got there. And one night, I and my friend had gone on one of these trips, had got kind of tired of that old heart attack. Now in France, we didn't have much. Our rations were very poor. And it was mostly heart attack and bully beef of some kind, and coughing. On this trip we found that when we were unloading the supplies at one of the stops where they were on a good stop when it came up there, we'll be back. We found 100 pounds of brush, and we thought we'd just have a big dinner. So George told me he was the best cook, rice cooker in Illinois, so I said, well, you go ahead. He borrowed a big kettle from a farmer's wife there and filled it half full of water. And he said, well, you got to help me drink that sack over here. So I went and helped me drink that 100-pound sack and poured it in that kettle. We didn't know what to think about. Did you ever cook rice? Well, that farmer's wife was just looking like this. And when that kettle exploded, she was gone. She went all around town and told all the people. And they come running in there with pans or anything to scoop up their rice. That rice was all over that day.
How come it exploded?
Yeah. It just a little bit of rice would make a great big bunch of cook. Well, 100 pounds. It just boiled over that kettle. And those people, they laughed. They couldn't talk. They couldn't speak Chinese, but they made signs of good luck and all that stuff. You know, thank you for a meal. So.
Would you describe the inside of the trench? What a trench is like on the inside?
Oh, the trench?
Yeah.
Nothing. Just a bare floor.
How deep were they?
Well, it must have been a 6 foot bank that stands up in it. So it must have been a little more than 6 feet high. And not too long, just for 40 men, or you could put 8 horses in there. But you put 60 men there, they had to stand up.
Yeah, and that was the train.
Well, I suppose the 40 could sit down, you know, but there were no seats in there. You know.
How many cars on each train? Would you describe the trenches that you were in?
Yeah, I just remember it rained over 300 days in France in 1917. The trenches nothing but mud. They had duck boards, we call them, on the bottom of the trench. But we throw it on top of the mud. And my book, I said, we ate in mud, slept in mud, tried to eat in mud. But we were grateful for the chill at night that kept us awake to fend off the ravenous rats. Rats would fall down and try to eat you. They'd been eating the dead. We just had a battle all night long. It was that long. I never saw such a rat. Well, that trench business was not too bad, but it was terrible.
How long were the trenches?
We stayed in the trenches maybe not over a couple of months. Percy is a wonderful general. He found out that the German army was training for open warfare. And the Allies were still taking to trench warfare. So he says, we're getting out of the trenches. I'm going to organize a school where young officers and promising enlisted men will be trained in the American way of waging war, open war. So he did that. And one day I was standing on the parapet looking over the dogfight going over. We had little planes. We didn't have any planes of our own. The Liberty planes that we had were called Flying Coffins. We only used them in the concerts the first of the war because the gas tank was unprotected and you trace your bullet. Hitting the gas tank was close to the plane. And well, I was watching a dogfight out there. There's no parachutes. And the loser would either jump out or ride his plane into the ground, you know, burn up it. And the winner would go up looking for another one. Well, I was standing there looking at him, and I saw a guy coming up on his boat board. I recognized him for sure. He was usually safe in the headquarters, in the dugout, you know, with a company headquarters. And I said, hey, Becker, you better get back in your hole. You're going to get wet or hurt, or maybe put out. He looked at him and said, yeah, something I sure have it easy. Never wash, never shave. And I said, I never get a decent sleep. He said, well, I'm going back in that hole and I'm taking you with me. I said, I won't give I like it. He says, you like it much better when you get to be an officer of the Army. So I was one of the guys that sent the scoop. And I was very pleased because this National Guard out there had a lot of my friends in it, you know, from Illinois. And see those guys get killed, it's pretty tough. But I knew if I did get commissioned, I'd be sent to a new outfit. And I was. I was sent to the 6th Infantry Regular Army of the 5th Division, where I fought the rest of the war. But we went back and on the way back, we had a gas alarm. We had to put on a mask. And you put those dang masks on you. The eyepiece would fog up and you couldn't see. And you wanted to walk in your band if they were blind. And we usually jerked ourselves up and got the gas because they had quit the cloud gas. That was depending on the weather, on the way the wind would blow. The cloud gas would look fine for now, but if they release that thing to go over the Allies, the wind might change, come right back on them. So they quit that and just use gas sails now.
Now what's the difference?
Well, high explosives about every third child was a gas ship. And you could, they used several times of gas. Faustine, I think, was the worst. That's the one that got me pretty bad.
What kind of gas?
Faustine gas.
Faustine?
Faustine. P-H-O-S-D-E-N-E, something like that. You can see it in the dictionary.
What kind of gas is that? What does it do?
It eats your lungs out. Mm-hmm. And you just cough up your lungs. But mustard gas was a burning kind. It was a heavy gas, and would settle. And as I said, the trench was always muddy, and the channels were always muddy. And that mustard gas would sink in the hold and lay there for maybe days. And if you'd come up and drop down one of the shells on those burning out, it was terrible.
You were in the St. Mihail?
Yeah, just a little while.
What'd you do there? What happened?
Well, no, I'd been commissioned to this school, and I was going to a new house. I got on a truck, and they herded me to the 6th Infantry, and they were, same here, was winding down too close. First thing was about one that long. But I was assigned to a complete stranger. I'd never seen one before. And all what we were doing were, it was sort of a, we were just not much fighting to do because the army was clearing out, retreating fast. What we were doing was just kind of protecting the rear and we didn't have much, I didn't have much. The St. Mihail was a real battle, but I was not in most of it. I was just in the cleanup operation. That's what I did. The country's full of dead people, the COVID people. And one German soldier just entered the ring out and he was full of mud, alive. And he begged me to shoot him. I couldn't do it. I just couldn't do it. I tried. My runner, I had three runners in those days, because we had no walkie-talkie. If you had anything to do, you had to send a runner back here. One of the runners said, "Lieutenant, I'm going back." I said, "Okay." He said, "I'll come back pretty soon." Now, he went back and came back. I never asked him, but I'm pretty sure he killed him. And I hope he did. Because he was really suffering. He knew he couldn't live. And then we were relieved by the 78th Division and began our slow march to the Argonne Forest.
Now, when you say you were in cleanup detail, what were you doing in the same? You said that you were in the cleanup detail of St. Mihail?
Not exactly cleanup, just protecting. I don't hardly know what our mission was. It was, we were, if we met in Germany, we were supposed to find them, and we did find a few that were left, suicide details were left behind to protect the retreating army. And the suicide groups is all we ever run into. But they were plenty glad to surrender because they all knew this one. And then we were, I wasn't in the St. Mihail over 2 weeks in. And we were relieved in by the 78th Division, and they went ahead. And relieved Alsace-Lorraine, that was the country that was being liberated. And I marked the Argonne mission. Well, the Germans had been occupying every place we went, and all the course was everything. And they could put that artillery on us any place they wanted to. They kept us busy getting out of cell holes or ditches, because you could hear those shells coming. You knew which ones were left, but close by the north. You'd fall down in the ditch, and then they started using everything to shell through the gas shell. You put on your gas mask, and then you couldn't see, and you went to the marching German. So you grabbed the mask off and took your chance with the gas. I think I called slow approaching to the orbit like a easy march through Daddy's Inferno. That was everything.
What happened to the Meuse Argonne?
I called it the Tunnel House of Death. It was terrible. The Germans had defended this place for 4 years against repeated attacks of both French and German. Pershing had recalled all regiments that were fighting with the French and British and made one big American army, two in fact, big American army. General Haig had just liberated Albanians, we really knew him that. And he wanted Pershing with his first army to capture the Argonne Fort. Germany had been fortifying this place for 4 years. They had traps. They had a well-fortified position, and it was a frontal attack. It wasn't pitching off a sailor. It was a frontal attack against all of these well-entrenched German soldiers. And Germany couldn't afford to lose, of course, because it was right close to their supply line. If they lost the force, they were going to lose this big supply line. And they weren't going to lose it, they thought. They say no one is a brave man. They're all afraid in cases like that. But no matter how afraid you are, you just got to go ahead. When 0 hour comes on, you just got to jump up and say, "Come on, you bastard. No one lives forever, and let's go." Well, you were scared as they were, but you had to go on. That went on day after day after day after day. I don't know how many. We finally won. One of our great attacks was that we came shortly in during the night under a heavy barrage to get our place behind. And as we neared our destination, they just gave us everything they had. And those were my shells all around, of course. And you crawled up and dropped into one of them. But you were glad it was real muddy. It was muddy ground, the shell. The concussion will travel to the muddy ground like it would sparking. And you hope that the concussions would get you if they didn't get you. Well, this day we had the battalion that I was in, the 1st Battalion. As all of them, the officers, almost every officer was killed. I was left with B Company, with another lieutenant and the captain. But D Company had only one first lieutenant left. And I was to be transferred to D Company the next day to help him. But today, as we say, it was just beginning. D Company was in line at right over 7:30 o'clock. That's another thing we learned. In our training, we learned that a kilometer was 9 miles. And it was earned at 24 o'clock. Because if you got an order, say, 12 p.m., you couldn't figure out whether it was noon or midnight. And they had to have like 12 in the morning or something like that. Or 12:13 or something.
What did you do specifically in the news order? What happened to you?
Well, I was a student man.
I'm sorry?
A platoon commander of the infantry, 6th Infantry. Well, I had leaked up platoon, of course, they were in tanks. And this day, we'd got in position, we were going over at 7:30 o'clock. At 7 o'clock, the barrage had kind of let up a little bit. And our mission was to capture a hill. The city of Romaine was on the left, boys of Apple Woods on the right, and this hill was covered by machine gun. And we were supposed to take that ridge. Well, I was scared. I think being scared helped a little bit. But one of my runs, I said, "Speak, crawl over and tell the captain the first, I had the first platoon. First platoon assault group. And tell the captain the first platoon's ready to go." Well, he looked right into his face and then he, with a smile, he grabbed me by the hand and crawled out of that hole. Just as the sun was getting out. I jumped up and called his name, fell in a new hole and found his body off. Oh, just call me. I was scared to death. I left two other runners in another hole too, and I climbed out of it to see if I could find the hair. And while I was laying there, I was scared. So I let my other two go. I could see their bodies just curling around up in the air. The torso held intact. That was my face, right in my face. I wiped it the little way. Let them walk. There's still 10 minutes to go. I thank God I had that 10 minutes to maybe just strength enough to tell the boys we've been late. And when they, the arms and legs of these two boys fell out a little far, I could hear them thump on the ground. And that changed me. I got so mad to join, I just couldn't wait to get out from them. I believe I said white terror changed to what for revenge. I was just determined to get help. Well, I looked again, there's still 5 minutes to go. And I said, well, you can have Germans get a break now. You'll have 5 more minutes. And I looked again, and I couldn't make out the time there. I took another look and there was a bloody scrap of paper that when it fell down in my face, that scrap of paper was stuck to the wrist of my face and my wrist was open. And I tore that off and looked at it and I met a time it was one straight down. I wasn't glad enough then, I was up again and give them help. And we went over there. We got a lot of them, they got a lot of us, but we did capture them. Yeah. And that went on day after day after day after day. When we left home, our motto was heaven, hell, or Hoboken by Christmas, back home by Christmas. And we kept saying that, heaven, hell, or Hoboken by Christmas. Day after day after day. One day, the artillery lit up with a mighty shell for them. The old saturated ground was always raining. There was a depth where you could see the raindrops falling around. And the boys were a little bit longer. When they get praised, they're going to shell as quick. And we wondered what had happened, and finally, battalion headquarters and our own patrol said the Germans had retreated. So we stopped, took care of the boys as best we could. They, on all the battlefields, a lot of corrugated iron laying around. They'd use it for something, I don't know what. Get that corrugated iron, lay it over a cell hole, and coal in there, and we carried canned heat. You could light that canned heat and get in under that cell hole and warm your feet, dry your socks. Well, they just got in there. When I had spied an old building a little bit in the front, all of us had. And either of us made a run to that place because he knew there'd be bombs in it. We got in that place and the Germans just left the day before right away. And it's full of lice. And boy, did we fight till the cooties too. But we finally dropped off the street when the order came that we had to change the front. So we had another long night march coming. And this is when we left the Oregon and crossed the Meuse. And as we got ready to go, the boys just raised hell. They didn't even have time to dry the warm feet, let alone dry the socks. They were accustomed to the very kid. And I looked back, and that old building that I'd been sleeping in was burning up, and an artillery shell was hit. So I just got out and tired there again. And we always, on the night march, we always said, keep your hand on the belt in front of you, don't get lost. You couldn't have lights, you couldn't smoke, you couldn't make any noise, but the plane drove and dropped a bomb on you. And we always thought maybe our machine gun battalion would get to us on purpose, because quite a few times when we go to the top, they weren't there to put down a protective garage over your head, you know. And we wound up at Bruel's, which had just been liberated on the drive. And the next morning we were to cross the Meuse on the pontoon bridges. Our Corps of Engineers had lost a lot of men putting those bridges up. And just across the Meuse was a canal running parallel with it, was well fortified by German soldiers. We crossed the Meuse on those bridges and there were too many men, and tuned up the canal and didn't find as much opposition as we expected. I think the Germans knew they were beat and didn't want to die in the last moment, so we lost cause. Anyway, we went through the Moselle Valley, the center of the wine industry, flooded the industrial section without too many losses, but the Germans were retreating to the high ground where they expected to make a stand, and they did. I don't know how I'm boring you about that.
No, go ahead, that is what we want.
And the other battalion, the one I was, fighting street to street in the time on this side. My battalion, the first, was in reserve, just on the 10th. This is the 10th of November. And I was going. called to headquarters and ordered to take a patrol out, find the exact location of both of our battalions and the terrain level. This was fighting on the heights, this was in the town, and we were back here. So I started out with a platoon, but the Germans started dropping shells on us, and I didn't think we needed any good fighting patrols, we were just on the cops, not supposed to. I turned the thing over to Colonel, told him to take it back and dismiss him, and report to the major what I had done, and the sergeant and I were going to continue the mission. We went ahead and got maps of the location of both battalions, and especially the one in town, because we were going to relieve them in the morning. And as we started back, we saw a company of artillery galloping up to the front. And of course, we had to go find out what was all going on. The captain of the outfit said, well, they're going to be an armistice tomorrow at 11 o'clock. And says, I've offered a prize to the gun crews here, the cash prize, the one that sends the most shells into Germany before the end of the war. He did that. The Germans, of course, responded and made a lot of unnecessary casualties. That was about it. The war was over at 11 o'clock. After listening to a big gun so long, the silence kind of hurt your ears. Until the Germans sprung out and we did too, run over and began shaking hands with people who tried to kill them into before, you know. They had good cookies and we didn't have anything sweet at all. When we were with the British, we had orange marmalade that we loved and had to drink tea with them. And we were just having a good time training the cigarettes for cookies. When the order came up, quit fraternizing with the Germans, so we had to quit. The Germans fell back to their place and were disarmed. We fell back over Nine Mile Hill for a short rest, and we were supposed to follow them into Germany. Our destination was Verdun. And 700,000 men killed here during the war of French and Germany. I don't know whether you heard of the trench bayonets or not. This is a French assault group was ready to go with help. They had longer guns than we did, much longer. And the bayonets were sticking out. The earth just closed in on them from the mini shell dropping dangers. And all that was left was that row of bayonets sticking up. Verdun had been the most strongly fortified town in France since the Franco-German War. And all we saw was a city full of rubble and completely smashed to pieces. Well, it was here that I was declared unfit for service. I didn't think I'd been wounded very bad, but in the book I wrote that the bullets in the gas mask had only left a streak of burned flesh, but somewhere on this, I said to me and my friend who was trying to take care of me, back to a field hospital. And I didn't mention this, but he said that on the way I passed out. And I did wake up with a bandage on my chest here. And very badly gassed. Anyway, they called a woman and gave me a wound shot. I don't know whether you're familiar with the Purple Heart had not. The Purple Heart was authorized by General Washington through the Revolutionary War, discontinued until World War II. We wore wooden stripes, golden arrows on our right sleeve, and about the service on our left. I'd been wearing that stripe, didn't think much about it because I didn't think I'd own it very much. And during World War II, they said, "It's Purple Heart." So I belonged to the National Order of Purple Heart, Disabled American Veteran, American Legion.
Was there a big celebration on Armistice Day where you were?
Sure.
Was there a big celebration there when the armistice was signed? You said that you were shaking hands with the Germans.
Oh, yeah.
What about that night?
Well, that night we were, they'd already stopped the fraternization. The Germans had gone back and we'd started back. And that's when I was declared unfit for service. I did get back to Verdun, but that's when they, when I couldn't go any further.
Did you go at there at Verdun, did you go where the big battles were? You know, I was over there here recently and went to the big forts that had been bombed
yeah,
and all that.
Yes. The Crown Prince lost 380,000 men. They're trying to take Verdun. And the French, their motto was, "They shall not pass." They lost 350,000 men. And it was a useless thing. There was no advantage for either side ever in the war. It was just a waste.
Have you been there recently at Verdun?
No, sir. I'd have to give anything to get back to France.
They have a big monument there now that has, it's a tomb of 150,000 unknown soldiers are buried there. And farmers would be out working, they'd find bones, they'd just collect them in this big, so now it's just this big monument, and there's, it's just a tomb for 150,000 unknown soldiers, French and German.
I know they were, it was a terrible
time. Oh, yeah.
They never surrendered. And according to history, nothing definite was decided during the war.
In fact, that's where the Trench of the Bayonets, I thought we'd visit that also.
You saw that?
Yeah.
Very good.
In fact,
that was
the United States put a big monument there.
Oh.
And the Trench, it has a cover over now.
Well, that's good.
Okay. When did you return to the States?
When I was released from the hospital, I was given orders to return to my outfit. They were in the army occupation of Trier, Germany. And I guess I believe it was T-R-E-V-E-S, but they call it Trier over there. You probably know as much about that.
It's Trier or Trev,
yeah.
Whether French or German.
Well, we took over a wonderful camp of German Jews. And my company had been augmented by two new second lieutenants. One of them was Lieutenant Moore, who was German instruction and spoke German perfectly. And the German lieutenant who had been wounded and decorated on the Eastern Front was in charge of maintaining this outfit, keeping the camp in order and so forth. And Moore had lodgings in his with him, and he talked him into letting me stay with him. So the fraternization was over now, and the German and his wife were very good to us. Their food had been restricted, they didn't have much to eat, but they invited me and Moore to stay in their house and eat with them. So we supplied them to my commissary with things they couldn't get, coffee, and things like that, especially candy bars or different kind of, all kind of fancy food, you know. And they took us all over that part of Germany. And boy, they could talk to Lord, he could talk to me. I couldn't understand the word. But I was the one that was, I guess, stealing for real, giving it to them. Anyway, this German presented me with a sword that he'd been awarded in the war for his service on the Eastern Front. He says, "I don't want the sword because it's unlucky. Says, my name is on one side of the blade and my wife's on the other." Well, I took the sword, but I knew I wasn't going to keep it because his family someday would like that thing. I wish 100 times maybe he did keep it and go at home, but yeah. I didn't want it.
Did you visit the Roman ruins there at Trier?
Yes. Yes, sir, I saw the... Now, I hope I don't get mixed up with another country we had to go to.
Well,
I have just a minute to...
Sure. You know, they have what they call the Black Gate, the Port of Negros.
So River, some 60 miles southwest of Koblenz. It was one of the oldest towns in Europe, a railroad junction, and the center of the Moselle wine section of Germany. Most intriguing to me, it was the site of the most important Roman ruins in Europe. We saw it firsthand, the Port of Negro, the well-preserved gate, the Romanesque cathedral holding the holy coat of Trier, supposed to be the seamless coat of Jesus, the 13th century Gothic Church of Our Lady, the old palace and the Roman bath. We found Germany apparently prosperous. Every inch of the countryside was under cultivation. The fields were dotted with grapevines and the houses without manure piles remind us of home. Is that what you talking about?
Mm-hmm. How long were you in the Army of Occupation?
Let me go ahead a little bit further and
try
to answer that. We left Trier for, to us, a little known country called sometimes at 92, sometimes your mind just don't work very good.
Was it in that area around Trier?
What?
Is it in the area around Trier?
Yeah.
Would it be Luxembourg?
Luxembourg, yeah.
Luxembourg.
Luxembourg, we always phoned up on the places we were going to. We found out that Luxembourg was Dutchy. The people were mostly German and French, but they had a national language of their own. But they were not allowed to use it. They used French and German in both publications and all business transactions. Germany had occupied Luxembourg from the beginning of the war in 1914 until the war was over. And they plundered the place. And they were very, very glad that we came in there, treated us like kings. Duchess Marie was I guess you'd call her the king or whatever the rulers are in those countries, Duchy. We saw her driving through the streets with a pair of blacks leading her carriage, driving around, and two guards in beige were following her behind. We got a big kick out of that. We've been all over Luxembourg. It was Luxembourg that out of you. I could read it out of you. But it was where I found the rat's killer. That was a kind of a swimming in the basement of one of the city buildings. And I would get a case of drink there, but I also heard that the 33rd Division, stationed nearby, was ordered home. So I immediately put in a transfer request for the old outfit and was given permission to go. And they were leaving to Hoboken. Now I'm trying to get the, that's when I left, so Hoboken was the, I was late to go with the division, so I had to go with a cash, as a cash soldier. I had to wait for transportation. I found that transportation by a wonderful German ship, the Imperator, which had been holed up in German ports all over the war. Passengers, beautiful. And I got to go home on that. I think I was discharged in, I think, May the 11th, 1919. That will not be too long, you know. It's not quite a year, anyway.
About 6-7 months.
Yeah, 6-7.
How, anything happened the trip back to the States?
Oh, it was wonderful. We, as I said, it was a beautiful passenger ship, and we had staterooms and everything, you know, and each cabin stateroom had it. When we pulled into New York Harbor, we were met by a flotilla of small ships, boats, with carrying welcome home signs. And I have a picture of us standing along a ship rail and the boats around. Everybody was clapping their hands, you know. And as we got off, we, this don't sound too good, I guess, we were met by a bunch of Red Cross, and they had a big, they had to throw money in, you know. But we didn't throw any money in because we remember now we had to pay a dime for a package of cigarettes. The Salvation Army gave us free cigarettes and donuts. Every time we went into line, they'd be there to give us something, you know. And they were the ones we were crazy about. But we also met another delegation. One, they seemed, I was with Turkey boys, just rolling around through the streets in New York. I forgot off the boat. And they come running up to us and said, "Where is he? Where is he?" We had no idea what he's talking about. Oh, Sergeant York came in on the Imperator and we wanted to give him a big celebration. You remember Sergeant York, I guess. And they left us right away. We didn't know how
to. Did you pass the Statue of Liberty coming back?
Sure.
Did you pass the Statue of Liberty coming back from France?
I'm sure we did. Now, sometime in these two trips that I was in New York, going and coming back, I went to the top of the, walked up to the top of the Statue. And that was a great experience.
What did you think about it when you came back, the statue, when you saw it?
We never lost the love for our country. We always loved our country. And she was something. And she still is. I hear they have renovated her now. She's good as new. I was a little bit disgruntled when I come back. We were not very well educated. We had not much work experience. And we were turned loose. the OTR bill. We swarmed like locusts through the streets of New York and different places looking for jobs. And most of the parks in New York had signs, soldiers and dogs keep off the grass. And if a soldier was found asleep on one of those benches at night, a policeman would come along with his club and give him the hot flint, you know. But I didn't sleep in any park. I got on a train and went to Rockford, Illinois, where I was going to be discharged.
What'd you do after the war?
Well, I was lucky. My sister was living in a little town in Indiana. Her husband was a newspaper editor of the Weekly, and he was quite a musician and run the local orchestra band. Later in life, he became quite popular on TV with his trombone. He was real musician. I visited her, and she had a visitor that day. And he was director of the Indiana State Highway Commission. And he wanted to know if I wanted a job. I said, sure, I want a job. So he gave me a job as director of the Oakwood section of the Illinois Highway. I was given trucks and permission for all the teams I wanted. And at that time, Indiana, Ohio was the only state really that had good concrete roads. Indiana was gravel and mud roads. Well, I was supposed to build these mud roads into good gravel roads for several miles. And I could use anybody I wanted to, or all the teams I wanted, and I was furnished with the trucks. And I turned that road into a beautiful highway. And one day a farmer came along, and he was smoking a cigar. And the ashes were about this long, right there in the cigar. He said, O'Neill, I've rode this road many, many times. He said, I never did have to set the ashes off my cigar till now. So he did that. It's as smooth as this road. And then, I'm a Republican, you know, and Illinois, I could see the handwriting on the wall, and they were going to elect a Democratic governor. And in those days, to the winner belonged the spoils. If you were in the wrong party and had a job, you were kicked out and the new man put in. I knew I'd be fired, and at that time, there was an opening for rural care in a town in Indiana. So I took this examination and was born rural care. I loved that job because I only had about 100 boxes, and I could go to work at 8 o'clock and get home by noon and take my couple of boys out swimming and fishing and the rest of it. But FDR was there, and here it was again. They couldn't farm it. Oh, well, first, before that, I was a stranger there. And there's a lot of local people who wanted to be postmaster. And the postmaster's job was coming up. So I took the examination for postmaster because I'd get a little bit more money and we wouldn't have to furnish more. In those days, rural care was furnished on the car. Eventually, they did get 4 cents a mile for traveling, but I didn't. I didn't get anything. I just got to stop. And with postmaster, I get a little more money. So I took that examination, and the rest of the boys fighting for the job were got tied up, and they gave me the job as postmaster. So I was postmaster there for 13 years.
And what was the name of the town?
Huh?
What was the name of the town?
Carlisle, Indiana.
Carlisle, Indiana.
C-R-L-I-S-L-E, just like it's come out.
Right. And Did you, what about the rise of Hitler in Europe? Were you aware of, you know, the Germans and Hitler and his Nazi party and all that?
Yes, we weren't aware of the Holocaust and the killing of the Jews. I don't believe we were. I know we were at this time.
Well, that didn't start what, until the late 30s? That started what, the middle 30s, late 30s, the Holocaust?
Right during the Depression.
Yeah.
No, I was lucky in the Depression because I was postmaster until FDR was elected, and he couldn't fire me because I was from the civil service. But they made life so miserable, I stayed 3 years in his first term and then resigned. Inspectors would come around and try to find something wrong. They could fire me for cause, but not for, because I was a Republican. And I finally resigned, and then the president hit me. I couldn't find a job. I was 50 years old. And resigned, and finally, I was a reserve officer at that time, all the time. Each year, I would be called active duty for training. Some days, 15 days with the regular army outfit. One time with the tank corps, and I really enjoyed that because I could drive those tanks and duck down them trees. But usually it was 4 to 5 days. I'd be 4 or 15 days for kind of brushing up course, and then I'd have a CMTC company. You remember that?
Yes.
Civilian Military Training Corps. I had several of those companies during this time, and I was always glad to have them because I got two payrolls in my job at the post office and in the Army, too. And I don't know, I...
Did you do any work?
I finally bought a couple of trucks, semi-trailers, and tried to make a living, but eventually I went broke. Then I joined the CCC, you remember that?
Yes.
I had a company of CCCs. And I just really enjoyed that.
Tell me about that. What'd you do?
Well, they were... This camp was, that I was in, was all veterans from World War I. They were mostly alcoholics, and of course they couldn't make a living outside, and they were in this camp. They got $15 a month. And their families were also given $15. So that wasn't too bad during the Depression. There were a lot of people working for a dollar a day if they were working at all. And,
where was the camp, CCC?
Mine was Southern Illinois, and I've been trying to think of the name of the camp because CCCs are hounding me now. They've got an organization on, they want me to join. And I did join, but I can't think of the name of the company I was in. I enjoyed it because I had plenty of time to, I was always a fool for exercise. I guess I was the original jogger around here, and see nowadays all every place. I'd done that in high school.
What were your duties at the CCC? What'd you do?
What?
What were your duties at the CCC? What did you do?
Well, you know what a captain of company does. I was not always a captain. When I joined, I had to resign my commission because nobody had the idea to be another war. And the reserves officer had to go to camp every year. If you visit to the camp. Also, he had to be answer corresponding courses all the time. And I got disgusted and resigned my commission. And I was a private when I went into the CCCs. I mean, I was out of the Army. They made me first mess sergeant. I had some experience as a hotel steward in St. Louis. And I didn't like that at all very well, and eventually I I was transferred to the engineering corps. This is where we started contour planting, you know, around the hills and planting walnut trees all over the southern part of the line. And that's about all we did, except it learned the boys how to live in the camp, get along together, and they were all ready for World War II when they came.
What were you doing on Pearl Harbor Day?
I was in St. Louis, riding on the streetcar. In those days, you could hear radios blaring most anywhere. And I heard them. I went right home, sent a telegram to the War Department, stating where I was at, and asked to be called active duty. And I was called active duty. I didn't get overseas. I made a dozen applications for duty overseas, and they said, you're too loud with your eyes exploding to my training command here in the States. But I think they just thought it was too old.
What'd you do in the training command?
The 47th Academic Squadron, we called it. It was a squadron, worked three shifts, 8 hours apiece, training airplane pilots, not pilots, but radio operators and mechanics.
Where was this?
Madison, Wisconsin. Eventually, running three shifts, we would send a bunch of graduates every month. We'd have a bunch of graduates. There were three of these squadrons training these radio operators and mechanics. We'd be able to send quite a bunch overseas, you know. And I found out how easy it was for enlisted men to get overseas. And when the war was winding down a little bit, they combined all of the three squadrons into one and made me transportation officer. So I was in charge of troop trains and everything, freight shipments and everything else. But until, as I said, I resigned my commission and enlisted to get overseas, and I got over there as enlisted. And I was enlisted then when I went to the CCCs.
Where'd you go overseas during World War II?
My first assignment was Okinawa, and then Japan, Tokyo, and that was Guam.
Well, did you go overseas after the war was over?
It was just about over. But I went over to listen. But in the meantime, as I said, I joined the Army out of high school. I had graduated from high school, but I spent a little time going to business college in St. Louis. And when I asked my wife, I said, would you mind to be the wife of this man again? She said, no, I wouldn't. So I enlisted with enough length to enable her to go with me. So we traveled all over the world. Tokyo, Tokyo. Any place you can take her with me. Bangkok.
When did you move to Oklahoma?
Last year.
When? Yes, sir.
They called me an Oklahoma regiment resident. I'm actually, I didn't tell him that. I don't know the man who interviewed people down at the convention. Knew I was in Oklahoma. What happened, as I told you, I was married just before I got on the boat to go overseas in France. And we were all set, every plan was made for to celebrate our 70th wedding anniversary on the 24th of March. My wife died on the 5th of March. So they went ahead and had a memorial for her. She's buried in Arlington National Cemetery, and I'm supposed to go there too. But I wanted to stay at home. I had a beautiful home up there. And I have two daughters. And they would come and stay with me maybe a month at a time, but they had families back here, you know. And I advertised for a live-in apartment, a woman. I didn't know how it would sound. Asking people, they said it'd be perfectly all right with your age. You could find a nice woman to come and live with you. But I just couldn't find anybody. And this daughter here is one of them. She kept coming over and staying a month. And she had to come back, and then the other daughter come, and she finally persuaded me to come over here and live with them. That was, when did we come over here, honey?
Well, it's just been this year. Right. My mother died in March.
The last March, after the, quite a little bit after the year.
Of course, both parents had visited here quite a while before that.
Yeah.
I was going to ask, when you first joined the National Guard in 1916, did you have monthly meetings or a weekly meeting that you attended?
No, because I joined just when they were ready to go to the border.
Okay.
I don't know what I know they did. They went to camp every year, mm-hmm. like they do here. And they were pretty good soldiers, but as I said, they were not the Eli's of the cities.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't very popular in those days. It is now, I think. And Oklahoma has a wonderful National Guard.
How would you compare, this may not be a fair question, but World War I to World War II?
The American Army is better prepared for World War II. I remember President ordering the country to make 50,000 airplanes a year. And I was tickled to death, because World War I, we didn't have an airplane worthy to be called an airplane. We had delivery airplanes, but as I told you, the tracer bullet was exploding. And we used French and English airplanes. And the president knew that war was going to come. He started the leasing program and got prepared pretty well. The fighting was different. It was better prepared, better war. I said in the book, I think, the veterans of World War I, their grandfathers now, and their sons knew a more complex war. But our war, like any war, whatever it is, brings thoughts too deep for tears. Another thing, they have changed the organization of the Army. In our war, it was four. battalions, four companies of battalion, the 250 men. If you had three companies of line, it was two long in line. One reserve back in held in reserve was not enough to reinforce the line. If you held two companies back, it was too many. Now it's three. So you can have two in line, one reserve, and it works much better. Combat groups, they call them. Yes, they were better soldiers than we were, I guess.
Well, anything else that you want to talk about?
I can't think of anything. I guess I've bored the heck out of you.
Oh, no. We've been talking for almost 2 hours.
2 hours?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I can't. Tell me something about, shut that off if you want to.
Okay.